family of God, sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. You understand that? We're not in their register. They don't know us. If they check up our names in their register, they will not find our name there, because the name of Jesus was not in their register. They didn't accept him. They didn't believe him. They didn't recognize him. They didn't approve of him. He was not in their register, but God approved of him. Behold, my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. And the same thing that happened to Christ has happened to us. They don't recognize us. They don't accept our manner of life. They don't accept the righteousness we hold. They don't accept the holiness we believe. What manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the children of God, the sons of God. Then he says, therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. He's saying, we don't wait until we die to become the children of God or sons of God. Now, at this present time, we get born again here on earth. We get saved here on earth. We get sanctified here on earth. And it is right now, at this present time, when we get saved, that we become the children of God. Behold, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Verse 3, and every man in any church, every man in any denomination. You see, many people today, they have made a great mistake. Like, it's like if a child will tell you, I go to a great school. Don't tell me that. Are you a great student? I go to a great school. Don't tell me that. What kind of student are you in that great school? Somebody says, I live in a great city. Don't tell me that. What kind of citizen are you in that great city? Somebody says, I belong to a great community. Don't tell me that. What kind of person are you in that community? I go to a great church. And once you see the sign of that church on my car, you know that I am somebody. No, not at all. Every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. That you belong to this church or any other church doesn't say much. It depends on what you do with what you are hearing, what you are learning. As you accept what you are learning, and it works out in your life, that's what matters. That's why it says, every man in whichever church that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. Whosoever committeth sin transgresseth also the law. That one is not doing the will of God, for sin is a transgression of the law. And you know that he was manifested to take away our sins. In him is no sin. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. He does not take delight in sinning. He does not take sin as a habit. He does not take sin with pleasure. He does not look forward to committing sin, planning to sin, and executing that plan, and living in sin. And then it becomes hardened in that, and he says, everybody knows me. I will do what I want to do. I will say what I want to say. I will go wherever I want to go. If they don't like it, that's their business. That's my choice. That's my way of life. That's not a child of God. The one that takes pleasure in sinning. The one that makes a habit of sinning. The one that deliberately goes into sinning. And he doesn't bat an eye. He doesn't wink. He doesn't even feel it at all. That's not a child of God. Whosoever abideth in him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth has not seen him, neither known him. Little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. That's a characteristic of a real child of God. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, as even as he that is righteous. It's not he that professes righteousness, he that believes the doctrine of righteousness. He that doeth. His language shows that he believes that righteousness. His demeanor, his character, his conduct shows he believes that righteousness. His sensitivity to resisting evil, resisting sin, shows that he actually believes in righteousness. He that committed sin, verse 8, is what? He that committed sin, I'm waiting for you, is what? Of the devil. I'm surprised. You find people, you know, a policeman catches them. And then they even give bribes. And after they've given the bribes, they say, my friend, by the way, which church do you go? Don't mention Deeper Life. Because you do not show that you believe, you belong to a church that believes in holiness. You're of the devil. He that committed sin is of the devil. For the devil sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin. He doesn't want to. He cannot because he doesn't want to. He cannot because he says, that's not my desire. I don't delight in that. That's not my manifest. Here is how you find the characteristics of the real children of God, the family of God. It is manifest, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his neighbor. It tells us in 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14. It says, as obedient children, there's a family of God, obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the former lusts in your ignorance. If you're no more ignorant of the demands of God, you're no more ignorant of the requirements of the gospel, then you will not say, well, I didn't know that. You know, because the Spirit of God abides in the child of God. But as he which has called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. Those are the characteristics of God's family. Now we come to the great commandment in God's family. Mark chapter 12, the great commandment in God's family. Here the Lord is telling us himself. Here are the words of Jesus Christ. Mark 12, reading from verse 29. Somebody had asked a question, and Jesus Christ answered the question. And after Jesus answered the question, the man replied again and responded to the answer of Jesus. And then Jesus passed a final comment that makes us to know the great commandment in God's family. Mark chapter 12, verse 28. It says, and one of the scribes came, and having heard them reasoning together, and perceiving that he had answered them well, asked him, which is the first commandment of all? This man asked the Lord Jesus Christ, can you tell me the first commandment of all? The greatest commandment of all the commandments? And Jesus answered him, the first of all commandments is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. Here the Lord Jesus made it very clear. If you're thinking about a child, being a child of God, you want to be a delight of the Lord. You want to know the first commandment of God. And you want to give yourself to that as a priority. Here it is. You will love the Lord. That means you will love him and love everything he loves. Take delight in everything he takes delight in. And run the way of his pleasure, not your own pleasure. You will love him, number one, with all your heart. Number two, with all your soul. Number three, with all your mind. Number four, with all your strength. You know what that does? It's taking in your body, your strength. It's taking in your soul. It mentions there your mind and your soul. It's taking in your spirit. It's taking in the totality of man. Because man is spirit, soul, and body all together. You are a living soul. And the spirit gives you that life. And you live inside the body. And it's the body that manifests and demonstrates the strength and the power and the skill you have. And it says, with the totality of your being. It says, with the entirety of your being. From the point of your thinking, to the point of your planning, to the point of your doing. With your inner knowledge and your outside ability. With your brain and your mind. With your knowledge and your skill, with everything you have going for you in existence, you love him. Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Lay everything at his feet. I'll do your bidding. I'll do your will. I will delight in whatever you want me to do. I will manifest my love in that way. That's the first commandment. And the second is like it. Namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than this. That's a great commandment in God's family. Look at verse 32. And the scribe said unto him, well, master, thou hast said the truth. For there is one God, and there is none other but he. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love your neighbor, to love his neighbor as himself, is more than whole bunch offering and sacrifices. You know the point? This man had correct doctrine. This man accepted correct doctrine. This man said what Jesus has said. No other doctrine can replace that. But see what Jesus said in verse 34. And when Jesus saw that he answered discreetly, he said unto him, thou art not far from the kingdom of God. You are not there yet. That you answered question correctly doesn't mean you are there yet. You accept sound doctrine doesn't mean you are there yet. You assert, you accept, and you give a good response to what Jesus has said doesn't mean you are there yet. I believe the Bible from cover to cover, because the Bible is all of everything in the Bible hangs on these two commandments. You love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. And you love your neighbor as yourself. You have accepted that. That doesn't mean you are in yet. But you are not far. Take another step. Repent. been born again, have Jesus as your personal Savior, and let him do a recreative work in you, then you'll be there. You know what? You can be coming to the church. I accept everything they say. I will never argue with anything they say, because they show us from the Bible, they open from chapter to chapter, and they open from one book of the Bible to the other. I accept. That doesn't make you a child of God yet. That's good. That's good. Believe sound doctrine. That's great. Have it in the head. That's great. Let it transfer from your head to your soul, to your spirit, to your mind. And give everything you've got to obedience to the word of God. It's not mental assent. It's not, I accept it. I believe it. I can even write a note on it. I can write an outline on it. That's not enough. You must have a real bona fide experience of a real child of God. Love him with all your heart. Love him with all your soul. Love him with all your strength. Love him with all your mind. Let it be a practical thing we can see, well demonstrated. Love him like Abraham loved him. That's love. When God said, Abraham, bring your son, your only son. He didn't argue. God gave that son to me happily and joyfully, cheerfully, willingly. I gave it back to him. That's love. Love him like Moses loved him. That he walked with God as if he saw the invisible. And then he counted the riches of Egypt, of this world, as refuse, as nothing. Love him like Ruth loved him. That he said, don't tell me to go back from you. Where you go, I will go. Your people will be my people. And your God will be my God. Love him like Peter loved him. We must do what we have heard and seen of him. Love him like John, the beloved, loved him. And love him like Paul loved him. That he said, none of these things move me. He was willing to stake his life on the commandment of the word of God. When you love him like that, with all your soul, all your mind, all your strength, and nothing is too great for you to give up. If he demands that you give it up, that's the love he's talking about. It's practical. It's personal. It's experiential. And it's something you can see. Something you can tell. This is love. Let me ask you, have you ever given anything up for God? Something that looks important to you, essential to you, almost like part of your life, and your friends and your neighbors thought you could never do without that thing. You came into the gospel, and then you learned that that thing is not appreciated by the word of God, and that thing is contrary to the commandments of the Lord. As important as that thing appeared to be to you, are you able to give it up for the glory of God and because of the commandment of God? That's the practical thing we're talking about. Deuteronomy chapter 30. In Deuteronomy chapter 30, I'm reading here from verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 30, and we're reading from verse 6. It says, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thine heart. This old covenant, they had been, thinking about the circumcision.